And of course, you're depending on government bureaucrats to make that decision in order to micro-target these different sectors in the economy. And what's more, once you accomplish that, if it's even done well, you're then giving some workers in some sectors a higher wage at the expense of workers in another sector. Hi, I'm Benjamin Faust. Let's talk today about minimum wage. Is it harmful or hurtful? Let's review some of the more recent, in the last few years, the more recent research that has come out in a very general sense to see if science has anything new to say about this issue. The first part of this video, I'm gonna quickly review what science has known for a long time about minimum wage, and then we'll start to get into the exceptions and the more nuances, the more granular activities of more recent research. Let's start out with a standard supply and demand graph. Up here we have the price of wages. That's the wage rate there, and we have the quantity of labor down here on our x-axis. We have the supply curve, how much labor will be supplied, of course, and of course as prices go up, or as quantities higher, the supply is going to be higher. And of course, as prices are higher, those who hire workers demand less and they demand more at lower prices. And so, of course, they meet in the middle at what's called the market equilibrium. And this, of course, is where the buyers and sellers agree on a wage and a quantity of work. Just so you don't get confused, the purchasers are the businesses and the suppliers are the workers in this case, since we are talking minimum wage. And if we draw some lines out this way and that way, we're going to be able to say, just for an example, let's put a price here of $10 per hour is the prevailing wage in this particular market at this agreement level. And let's say it also means that employers want to purchase 1,000 hours of labor. Now, in the classic theory, what does minimum wage do? Well, if it's at or below $10, it does nothing. The wages stay the same, there's no distortions in the market, anything like that. The problem comes when the minimum wage goes above this market clearing price of $10. Let's go ahead and choose the politically popular $15 minimum wage. And so at this minimum wage rate, we're going to force the entire market. Everybody must pay workers a minimum of $15 an hour. We are going to have an effect from that. And the key here is at the intersection of this new minimum wage, the demanded hours are gonna fall. They're not gonna be 1,000 as they were at market equilibrium. They're gonna be lower. Let's go ahead and put an amount there of say 700 hours purchased. But yet, because the wages are higher, people who are workers wish to either engage in more hours of work, or those who were not working decide to join the workforce because now it's worth it for them. And so the supply of the market is now at let's say 1,200 hours. And so of course, as we finish this up, we now have a demand of only 700 hours. And due to the price being what it is, we also have a supply of 1,200 hours, meaning that there's a surplus of labor or a surplus of workers in terms of 500 hours. So I have my angry red pen here, and right here we're gonna write surplus. And again, surpluses often to our ears sound good. Oh, there's a surplus of this, that means I can get more of it. But remember, the suppliers are the workers and the business owners are the demanders. And so if we have a surplus of workers, that means we have workers that are willing to work but cannot find a job. This surplus, we should, in our minds, because it's minimum wage, we should think of this surplus as either unemployment or underemployment. And of course, 500 hours is the difference between what is purchased and what is provided. It means some people are idle at home, probably playing video games, something like that. Now, as I said before, we're gonna go deeper into the theory, but this still has an effect that is felt today. The nonpartisan Congressional Budget Office in 2019 did an analysis and predicted that a nationwide minimum wage in the United States of $15 per hour would actually result in 1.3 million jobs lost. What's that? I hear a question. Yes, there are certain environments, and we've known this for a long time also, where this kind of model no longer holds water. And since 2020 has been a year of quarantine, hunkering down, I'm sure some of you popped popcorn, made fudge, and played this game. And of course, most of us know that Monopoly means one seller. But economics has another word that we use when there's only one buyer, monopsony. In a monopsony environment, things start to look a little bit different. A monopsony labor environment is where you're in a situation where an entire area, region, or town only has one major employer. An example would be something akin to the one company coal towns you saw in eastern Kentucky and West Virginia back in the day. You could also make the case, perhaps, that the Kim regime's government in North Korea is a monopsony, since the state, on the surface anyway, employs all the workers. It's a relatively rare environment to have a pure monopsony labor market, but the science on it looks a little bit different than this standard which we just went over. I'm just gonna really briefly show you what I'm talking about. If you want a more detailed analysis of this, or you want to fully understand exactly what's going on this chart, I recommend you do an internet search for monopsony, employers, and minimum wages to get a little bit more technical. But basically, here's what's happening. Well, in the standard chart where your supply and demand curves meet, you would see a market equilibrium. You're not going to see that in the same way. Because of the structure of the monopsony labor market, you have a marginal cost factor that's more steep than the supply curve for labor. It gives a huge advantage to the employer in this way. If we were at what was the market equilibrium, you're going to have this wage price at market equilibrium and this quantity of labor purchased quantity at market equilibrium. However, the monopsony employer will demand labor at this point here where their cost structure is in line, and then they will pay the wages down here. Here's the effect. You're actually getting at Q1 and P1, so the price of labor is actually going to be lower than it would be otherwise, and the amount of workers is actually going to be lower than it would be also. So in a more standard market, the objection is that if we have a minimum wage, it's going to cause people to lose their jobs. But that's not the case here. And in fact, if we impose a minimum wage, it will raise both the employment levels and the wages. As long as we don't overshoot it, of course. If we overshoot it, we're going to be in the same problem we were in the other model. Let's go ahead and impose a minimum wage right here and see what happens. As you can see, we've raised incomes and we have raised employment levels just by implementing a minimum wage. And in this case, we could go a little bit further to kind of optimize to go right at what would have been the market equilibrium had the labor market not been a monopsony. Let's go ahead now and get into kind of more of the recent research on the topic. First off, that monopsony environment we talked about second is now thought to be more on a spectrum rather than a, oh, it's only one employer, or no, there's more one employer. It's not an on or off switch, it's more like a spectrum. Perhaps on a spectrum like this, you could draw something like this. Over here, many employers, and then over here, this particular point, one employer here. And that doesn't mean that you're okay here, okay here, and then okay here, but as soon as you go from, like, say, two employers to one employer, then all of a sudden you're faced with a monopsony environment. That's not how it is. In fact, it's showing us that the further you get away from many employers on the spectrum, what happens is you transition from an environment where there's more competition for labor, and it becomes more and more disadvantageous for the worker as we go along. And so there's a lot of research looking at different regions of the country and different industries to determine exactly how concentrated the market is in terms of number of people willing to hire workers. In the United States, that seems to be your more urban areas, your larger cities seem to have more access to choice of employers, and the more rural areas seem to be locked into few employers. That being the case, you can kind of see how, in general, over here and over here are kind of on a spectrum, with most markets falling in between. I've seen studies on this in regards to location, urban, rural. I've also seen studies on this in regards to type of industry. Perhaps there's only one manufacturing firm in town, but there are multiple restaurants. Supposing the factory workers are relatively specialized and there's not a lot of people moving back and forth from the fast food restaurants, it might mean that a targeted minimum wage for a particular industry and a particular location could raise wages without consequence of loss of employment. This newer science also explains why a hike from $7.25, the current federal minimum wage in the United States, to $15 an hour is only going to result in 1.3 million jobs lost. Now, to those 1.3 million people, or anybody who's had their hours reduced, it's a big deal. But in terms of the 160 million or so people in the labor force, this is a less than 1% loss, and a lot of people would benefit from the higher wages. There's a lot of research also in determining exactly where the wage should be placed placed based on location and industry as to not overstep the bounds, but yet maximize the selling power of those workers selling their time and talents. So the question whether minimum wage is harmful or not is more nuanced than it has been in the past before we had these more recent studies. That being said, in order to make any minimum wage strategy effective and one that causes little to no harm to workers, relies heavily on government bureaucrats in order to make those calls. And it's a big assumption that political influences, biases, and pressure from other groups won't influence the outcomes. And what's more, depending on how a policy is implemented, in many cases it will still benefit some workers at the expense of others. Let me give you a specific example of that. Suppose there's a city existing by an interstate, and it has primarily two sources of employment in the town: retail workers and QSR workers. QSR standing for quick service restaurants. It means the same thing as fast food. And of course, both of these sectors employ workers, which I'm going to denote with the letter W. Suppose in this town that kind of the going rate for any worker is $10 an hour. Let's suppose also that the retail sector is dominated by maybe one or two major players, but that the QSR environment is dominated by multiple players. Meaning that we have a concentrated kind of monopsony sort of environment for this sector and more of a traditional model free market for this environment. Now, based on what we said earlier, which environment can we help more with minimum wage? If you said the concentrated market, the retail workers, you're absolutely correct. Let's go ahead then and set them a higher wage rate, assuming we have good economists that can do the math, figure out where we should be, and also armed with the knowledge that since it's a concentrated market, we may not be in danger of actually losing any workers while at the same time raising the wage. Let's go ahead and do $15 an hour. Is that the end of the story here? Absolutely not. If you're in fast food and you're seeing that people over at the retail store are making more money, what are you going to try to do? Absolutely, you're going to move over here and try to gain employment in the retail sector. What if you're a boss of the retail sector and you have some underperforming employees? What are you going to do? If you said fire them and hire the higher quality workers coming in from the fast food restaurants, you're absolutely right. So your retail environment is going to shed workers that may command lower wages and absorb those who can command higher wages. And the fast food market will end up taking workers that command less of a salary, while their higher skilled workers may go and migrate to retail. If only there were some way we could illustrate this. What was that? Good idea. Let's assign them a quality score, shall we? So I've assigned them a number 1 to 7, 7 being the highest quality worker or the worker who's older with more experience, 1 being the entry level worker without as much experience or for whatever reason commands lower wages. The average quality when we start out before we make that $15 change is going to be at $10 an hour. The quality score, if you took each score, added it up, divided it, taking the mean average, is going to be a quality score of 4. Same thing over here, it's going to be a quality score of 4. Once we implement the $15 minimum wage, you're going to have this happen. Your higher quality workers in the fast food restaurants are going to come over here and work for higher wages, while your lower quality retail workers, such as 1, 2, and 3 here, so this group here, they're going to come over here and work for quick service restaurants. When you do that, you're going to replace this 4 average with about a 5.7 quality score, and this average with about a 2.3 score. So the next question we have to ask is, when this sector raised minimum wage to 15, does this sector stay at 10 despite now having lower productivity workers entering into their industry? The answer is no. The wages in the quick service industry are going to fall. For purpose of illustration, let's say it falls down to a $5 wage. They were at 10, they fell to 5, while this other group went up to 15. So at minimum here, you have workers of even average quality that stayed here being punished by the minimum wage in another sector. But wait, this city somewhere is in the United States and is subject to a $7.25 minimum wage. Oh, what a relief. It's not going to be good for these fast food workers, but at least they're going to get a little bit more than they would have otherwise, right? That's true for some of them, but what is the restaurant owner likely to do in order to make his ratio work out, keeping his labor percentage under control to control his costs? If you said fire workers, and in particular, the less desirable workers, maybe the younger workers, or the workers with less experience, move to the head of the class. You're fired, you're fired, you're fired. So again, even with the new research coming out with minimum wage, we have to be very careful, again, being dependent on government bureaucrats in order to set it correctly. And even if they're successful, we have to watch out for negative effects that would happen in industries outside of the targeted improvement areas.